the show will run approximately 1 hour and 40 minutes. And the first act is an hour five. How the show is designed, it is designed in thrust, so the actors are completely surrounded. If you need to go to the bathroom, you're gonna have to wait because everything, so it's fully immersive. Have fun with that. We are not the only production in Bard Fest. We have Love Labor's Lost, Anthony and Cleopatra, and Macbeth that is running at the Love Labor's Lost, and Anthony and Cleopatra are running at the Cat up in Fishers. Macbeth is running at Theater in the Fort in Lawrence, and then we're going to close the festival with a modern, one of the contemporary shows called Elizabeth Rex. So check out bardfest.com for all of that fun information. Other than that, thank you for coming and welcome back to live theater. Yeah.
Speech and discourse, since I am put to know that your own science exceeds in that the list of all advice my strength can give you, then no more remains, but that to your sufficiency as yours is able, and let them work. The nature of our people, our cities, institutions, and the terms for common justice, you're as pregnant in as art and practice hath enriched any that we remember. There is our commission, from which we would not have you warp. What figure of us think you he will bear? For you must know we have with special soul elected him our absence to supply, lent him our terror, dressed him with our love, and given his deputation all the organs of our own power. What think you of it?
Oh, if any in Vienna be a person.
Always obedient to your grace's will, I come to know your pleasure.
Angela, there is a kind of character in thy life that to the observer doth thy history fully unfold. Thyself and thy belongings are not thine own so proper as to waste thyself upon thy virtues, they on thee. Heaven doth with us as we with torches do, not light them for themselves. For if our virtues did not go forth from us, 'twere all alike as if we had them not. But I do bend my speech to one that can my part in him advertise. Hold therefore, Angela. In our remove, be thou at full ourself. Mortality and mercy here live in thy tongue and heart. Dear Aeschylus, though first in question, is thy secondary. Take thy commission.
Now, good my lord, let there be more test made of his metal before so noble and so great a figure be stamped upon it.
No more evasion. We have with 11 and prepared choice proceeded to him. Therefore, take your honors. My haste prevents is of so quick condition that it prefers itself and leaves unquestioned matters of needful value. We shall write to you as time and our concerning shall importune how it goes with us, and do look to know what doth befall you here. So fare you well. To the hopeful execution do I leave you of your commission.
Give leave, my lord, that we may bring you something on the way.
My haste may not admit it. nor need you on mine honor have to do with any scruple. Your scope is as mine own, so to enforce or qualify the laws as to your soul seems good. Give me your hand. I'll prison you away. I love the people, but do not like to stage me to their eyes. Though it do well, I do not relish well their loud applause and obvious vehemence, nor do I think the man of safe discretion that does affect it. Once more, fare you well.
The heavens give safety to your purposes.
Lead forth and bring you back in happiness.
I thank you. Fare you well.
I shall desire you, sir, to give me leave to have free speech with you. And it concerns me to look in the bottom of the place. A power I have, but to what strength or nature I am not yet instructed.
'Tis so with me. Let us withdraw together, and we may soon our satisfaction have touching that point. Behold! Behold! Where Madam Mitigation comes. I have purchased as many diseases under her roof as come to what, I pray?
Thou art always figuring diseases in me, but thou art full of error. I am sound.
Nay, not as one would say healthy, but so sound as things that are hollow. Thy bones are hollow, and piety is made a feast of thee.
Oh, there's one yonder arrested and carried to prison worth 5,000 of you.
Who's that, I pray thee?
Mary, sir. Claudio.
Claudio to prison? 'Tis not so.
Nay, but I know it is so. I saw him carried away, saw him arrested, and what's more, within these 3 days, his head to be chopped off.
But after all this fooling, I would not have it so. Art thou sure of this?
I am too sure of it, and it is for getting Madame Julietta with child.
Believe me, this may be. He promised to meet me 2 hours since, and he was ever precise in promise-keeping. Away! I'll go learn the truth of this.
Thus, what with the war, what with the sweat, what with the gallows, and what with poverty, I am custom shrunk. How now? What's the news with you?
Yonder man is carried off to prison.
Well, what has he done?
Oh, woman.
But what is his offense?
Groping for trouts in a peculiar river.
What? Is he made with child by him?
No, but there is a woman with maid by him. You have not heard of the proclamation, have you?
What proclamation, man?
All houses in the suburbs of Vienna must be plucked down.
And what shall become of those in the city?
They shall stand for seed.
But shall all our houses of resort in the suburbs be pulled down?
To the ground, mistress.
There's a change indeed in the Commonwealth. What's become of me?
Come, fear you not. Good counselors lack no clients. Though you change your place, you need not change your trade. I'll be your tapster still. Courage, there will be pity taken on you. You that have worn your eyes almost out in the service, you will be considered.
What's to do here? Let's withdraw.
Fellow, why do they show me thus to the world?
They do it not in evil disposition, but from Lord Angelo by special charge.
Thus can the demigod authority make us pay down our offense by weight the words of heaven. On whom it will, and whom it will not, so yet still 'tis just.
Whence comes this restraint?
From too much liberty, my Lucio? Liberty? As surfeit is the father of much fast, so every scope, by the immoderate use, turns to restraint. Our natures do pursue, like rats that raven down their proper bane, a thirsty evil, and when we drink, we die.
What's thy offense, Claudio?
Oh, but to speak of would offend again.
What? Is it murder?
No!
Lechery?
Call it so. Lucio, a word with you.
100 if they'll do you any good. Is lechery so looked after?
Thus stands it with me. Upon a true contract, I got possession of Julietta's bed, You know the lady, she is fast my wife, save we do the denunciation lack of outward order, remaining the coffer of her friends, whom we thought it meet to hide our love till time had made them for us. But it chances that the stealth of our most mutual entertainment, with character too gross, is writ on Juliet.
With child, perhaps.
Unhappily, even so. And this new deputy, now for the Duke, whether it be the fault and glimpse of newness, or whether that the body public be a horse whereon the governor doth ride, who, newly in the seat, that it may know he can command, lets it straight feel the spur, whether his tyranny be in his place or his eminence that fills it up, I stagger it. But this new deputy awakens me all the enrolled penalties that have, like unscoured armor that has hung on the wall so long that 19 zodiacs have gone round and none of them been worn, and for a name puts the drowsy and neglected act freshly on me. 'Tis surely for a name.
I warrant it is. Send after the Duke and appeal to him.
I have done so, but he's not to be found. I prithee, Lucio, do me this kind service. This day, my sister should the cloister enter, and there receive her approbation. Acquaint her with the danger of my state, implore her in my voice to make friends to the strict deputy, bid herself assay him. I have great hope in that she hath prosperous art when she can play with reason and discourse, and well she can persuade.
I pray she may, as well for the encouragement of the like, which else would stand in her grievous imposition. As for the enjoying of thy life, who I would be sorry should be thus foolishly lost in a game of tic-tac. I'll to her.
Thank you.
Within 2 hours.
Good friend.
Assemblies where use and cost and witless bravery keeps. I have delivered to Lord Inn, a man of stricture and firm abstinence, my absolute power and place here. And he supposes me traveled abroad, for so I've strewed it in the common here, and so it is received. Now, pious sir, you will demand of me why I do this?
Gladly, my lord.
We have strict statutes and most biting laws, needful bits and curbs to headstrong weeds, which for this 19 years we have let slip, even like an o'ergrown lion in a cave that goes not out to prey. Now, as fond fathers, having bound up the threatening twigs of birch, only to stick it in their children's sight, for terror not to use, in time the rod becomes more mocked than feared. So our decrees, dead to infliction, to themselves are dead, and liberty plots justice by the nose. I have, on enfloating, closed the office, who may, in the ambush of my name, strike home. And yet my nature never in the fight to do in slander. And to behold his sway, I will, as for a brother of your order, visit both prince and people. Therefore, I prithee, supply me with the habit, and instruct me how I may formally, in person, bear me like a true priest. More reasons for this action, at our more leisure, shall I render you. Only this one, Lord Angelo's precise, stands at a guard with envy, scarce confesses that his blood flows, or that his appetite is more to bread than stone. And shall we see, if power change purpose, what our scene would be.
Hail, virgin! If you be as those cheek roses proclaim you are no less, can you so stead me as bring me to the sight of Isabella, a novice of this place, and the fair sister to her unhappy brother Claudia?
Why her unhappy brother? The rather, let me ask, because I now must make you know that I am at Isabella, dear sister.
Not to be weary with you, he's in prison.
Woe me, for what?
For that which, if myself might be his judge, he should receive his punishment and thanks. He hath got his friend with child.
sir, make me not your story.
It is true. I would not, though 'tis my familiar sin with maids, to seem to lap wing and to jest, tongue far from heart, to play with all virgins so. I hold you as a thing enskied and sainted by your renouncement, an immortal spirit, and one to be talked with in sincerity as with a saint.
Sir, you do blaspheme the good and mocking me.
Do not believe it. Fewness and truth, 'tis thus. Your brother and his lover have embraced.
Someone with child by him, let him marry her.
This is the point. The Duke is very strangely gone from hence. Upon his place, and with full line of his authority, governs Lord Angelo, a man whose blood is very snow broth, one who never felt the wanton stings and motions of the sense, but doth rebate and blunt his natural edge with profits of the mind, steady and fast. He, to give fear to use and liberty, which have for long run by the hideous law as mice by lions, hath picked out an act under whose heavy sense your brother's life falls into forfeit. He arrests him on it and follows close the rigor of the statute to make him an example. All hope is gone, Isabel, unless you have the grace by your fair prayer to soften Angelo.
Doth he so seek his life?
Has censured him already, and as I hear, the provost hath a warrant for his execution.
Alas, what poor abilities and mean to do him good?
Assay the power you have.
My power, alas, I doubt that.
Our doubts are traitors, and make us lose the good we oft might win by fearing to attempt. Go to Angelo, and let him learn to know, when maidens sue, men give like gods. But when they weep and kneel, all their petitions are as freely theirs as they themselves would owe them.
I'll see what I can do.
But speedily!
I will about it straight. I humbly thank you. Commend me to my brother. This night I will send certain word of my success.
I take my leave of you.
Good sir, adieu.
We must not make a scarecrow of the law, setting it up to fear the bird's prey, and let it keep one shape, till custom make it their perch and not their terror.
Aye, but yet let us be keen, and rather cut a little than fall and bruise to death. Alas, this gentleman, whom I believe to be most straight in virtue, that in the workings of your affections had time cohered with place, or place with wishing, or that the resolute acting of your blood could have attained the effects of your own purpose, whether you had not some time in your life erred in this point which you now censure him and hold the law upon you.
'Tis one thing to be tempted, Aeschylus, another thing to fall. I not deny the jury passing on the prisoner's life may in a sworn 12 have a thief or two guiltier than they try. What's open made to justice, that justice seizes. What knows the laws that thieves do pass on thieves? You may not so extenuate his offense, for I have had such faults. But rather, tell me, when I that censure him do so offend, let mine own judgment pattern out my debt, and nothing come impartial. Madam, he must die.
Be it as your wisdom will.
See that Claudio be executed by 9 tomorrow morning. Bring him his confessor. Let him be prepared.
Heaven forgive him. Forgive us all. Some rise by sin, and some by virtue fall.
Come, bring him away! These be good people in the common will that do nothing more than use their abuses to the common houses. I know no law. Bring them away.
How now, sir? What's your name? And what's the matter?
Please your honor, sir. I am the poor Duke's constable, and my name is Elbow. I do lean upon justice, sir, and bring here before your good honor two notorious benefactors.
Benefactors? Well, what benefactors are they? Are they not malefactors?
If it please your honor, I know not well what they are, but precise villains they are, that I am sure, and void of all profanation in the world that good Christians ought to have.
All this comes off well. Here's a wise officer.
Go to. What are you, sir?
Heat, sir. A taster, sir. Parcel bawd. One that works for a bad woman, whose house was, as they say, plucked down in the suburbs. She now professes a hot house, which I believe to be a very ill house, too.
How dost thou know that?
By my wife, sir, whom I detest before heaven, and your honor.
How, thy wife?
By my wife, whom I, thank heaven, is an honest woman.
Dost thou detest her, therefore?
I say I detest myself also, as well as she, if this house be not a bond's house, with the pity of her life, for it is a naughty house.
How dost thou know that, Constable?
Mary by my wife, sir, who, if she had been a woman cardinally given, might have been accused of fornication, adultery, and all uncleanliness there.
By the woman's means?
Aye, sir, by Mr. Soberden's means.
Sir, if it pleases your honor, this is not so.
Prove it for these varlets here. Prove it.
Do you hear how these places?
Sir, she came in great with child and longing, saving your honor's reverence for stewed prunes. Sir, we have the two in the house which at the distant time stood, as it were, in a fruit dish of some 3 pence. Your honors have seen such fruit dishes. They are indeed very good dishes.
Go to, no matter, for the dish, sir.
No, indeed, sir, not of opinion you are there and in the right, but to the point. This Mistress Elbow, as I said, being with child, and being great-bellied, and longing, as I said, for stewed prunes, and having but two in the dish, as I said, Master Froth here, this very man, having eaten the very rest, as I said, and as I say, paying for them very honestly. For as you know, Master Froth, I could not give you 3 pence again.
All this is true.
Why, very well then, I hope
you... Oh, come, you are a tedious fool. To the purpose, what was done to Elbow's wife that he had cause to complain of? Come to me, what was done to her?
Sir, your honor cannot come to that day.
No, sir, I mean it not.
Madam, but you shall come to it by your master's leave. And I beseech you, look into Master Froth here, a gentleman of 40 pounds a year, whose father died at Hollowmas. Was it not Hollowmas, Master Froth? Very well, then, I hope here be truth.
This will last out a night in Russia. The nights are longest there. I'll take my leave and leave you to the hearing of the cause, hoping you'll find good cause to whip them all.
No, I think no less. Tomorrow. Oh. Come now. What was done to Albo's wife? Once more.
Once, madam, there was nothing done to her once.
I beseech you, sir, ask him what he did to my wife.
I beseech you, madam, ask me.
Well, sir, what did this gentleman to her?
I beseech you, madam, look in this gentleman's face. Good Master Froth, look upon her honor. It's for a good purpose. Doth your honor mark this man's face?
Aye, sir.
May I beseech you mark it well?
Well, I do.
Doth thou see any harm in his face?
Why, no.
Be supposed upon a book. His face is the worst thing about him.
Good.
Now, if his face be the worst thing about him, how could Master Froth cause the constable's wife any harm? I would know of that, Your Honor.
He's in the right. Constable, what say you to it?
First, and it like you, the house is a respected house. Next, this is a respected fellow. And his mistress, the respected woman.
By this hand, madam, his wife is a more respected person than any of us all.
Oh, varlet, thou liest, wicked varlet. The time has yet to come that she is ever respected with man, woman, or child.
Madam, she was respected with him before he married with her.
Oh, which is the wiser here, justice or iniquity? Is this true?
I respected with her before I married her. If ever I respected with her, or she with me, let not your worship think me the good duke's officer. Prove it, or I'll have my action of battery upon thee.
Oh, truly, officer, because he hath some offenses in him that thou wouldst discover if thou couldst, let him continue in his courses till thou knowest what they are.
Mary, I thank your worship for it. Thou shalt seest now, wicked varlet, what is to come upon thee. Thou art to continue now, varlet. Thou art to continue.
Where were you born, friend?
Here, sir.
And what trade are you of?
Poor widow's tapster.
Your mistress's name?
Mistress Overdone.
Hath she had any more than one husband?
9, madam, overdone by the last.
9? Come hither to me, Master Froth. Master Froth, I would not have you acquainted with tapsters. They will draw you, Master Froth, and you will hang them. Get thee gone, and let me hear no more from you.
I thank your worship. For my own part, I never come into any room in a tap house, but I'm drawn in.
Well, no more of it, Master Froth. Farewell. Come hither to me, Master Tapster. What's your name, Master Tapster?
Poppy.
Poppy, you are partly a bawd. Howsoever you color it, being a tapster, are you not? Come, tell me true, it shall be the better for you.
Truly, madam, I'm a poor fellow that would live.
But how would you live, Pompey? By being a bawd? How do you find the trade, Pompey? Is it a lawful trade?
The law will allow it.
But the law will not allow it, Pompey, nor it shall not be allowed here ever.
Does your worship intend to geld and slay all of the youth of the city?
No, Pompey.
Truly, madam, in my poor opinion, they will do it.
There are pretty orders beginning, I can tell you. Tis but heading and hanging.
If you head and hang all that offend that way for 10 years together, you'll be happy to give out a commission for more heads. If this come to pass, say Pompey told you so.
Thank you, good Pompey. And in requital of your prophecy, hark you. I advise you, let me not find you before me again on any complaint whatsoever. No, not for dwelling where you do. If I do, Pompey, I shall have you whipped. So, for this time, Pompey, fare you well.
I thank your worship for good counsel, but I shall follow it better as flesh and fortune shall better determine. Whip me? No. Let a carman whip his jade. The valiant heart is not whipped out of his trade.
Now, what's the matter?
Is it your will Claudio shall die tomorrow?
Did not I tell thee yea? Hast thou not order? Why dost thou ask again?
Lest I might be too rash, I have seen under your good correction where judgment after execution hath repented or is doomed.
Go to. Let that be mine. Do you your office or give up your place, and you shall be well spared.
Crave your honor's pardon. What shall be done, sir, with the groaning Juliet? She is very near her hour.
Dispose of her to some more fitter place, and that is speed. Let her have needful but not lavish means. There shall be order for it. Take leave, Eskils. You're welcome. What's your will?
I'm a woeful suitor, to your honor. Please let your honor hear me.
Well, what's your suit?
There is a vice, which most I do abhor and most desire should meet with the full of justice, for which I would not plead, but that I must. For which I must not plead, but that I am at war, which will and will not.
Well, the matter?
I have a brother who is condemned to die, and I do beseech you, let it be his fault and not my brother.
Condemn the fault, and not the actor. Why, every fault's condemned, ere it be done. Mine were the very cipher of a function, to find the faults whose fine stands in record, and let go by the actor.
Just but severe law, I had a brother then. Must he needs die?
Maiden, no remedy.
Yes, I do think you might pardon him, and either heaven or man grieve at the mercy.
I will not do it.
But can you, if you would?
Look, what I will not, that I cannot do.
But might you do it, and do the world no wrong, if so your heart were touched with that remorse as mine is to him?
He's sentenced. 'Tis too late.
Too late? Why, no, I did you speak a word and call it back again. But believe this. To no ceremony this great one's longs, not the king's crown, the deputed sword, the marshal's truncheon, nor the judge's robes become them with one half so good a grace as mercy does. If you had been as he and he as you, you would have slipped like him, but he, like you, would not have been so stern.
Pray you, be gone.
I would to heaven I had your potency and you were Isabel. Should it then be thus? No, I would tell what 'twere to be a judge and one a prisoner.
Your brother is a forfeit of the law, and you but waste your words.
Alas, alas, by all the souls that were forfeit once, and he that my advantage best have took found out the remedy. And how would you be if he, who is the top of judgment, should but judge you as you are? Well, think on that, and mercy then will breathe within your lips like man new made.
Be you content. Fair maid, it is the law, not I, condemn your brother. Were he my kinsman, brother, or my son, it should be thus with him. He must die tomorrow.
Tomorrow? He is not ready for death. Even in the kitchens we kill the fallow season. Should we serve the heaven with less respect than we do minister to our gross selves? Good Good, my lord, but thank you. Who is it that hath died for this offense? There's many have committed it.
The law hath not been dead, though it hath slept. Those many had not dared to do that offense if the first that did the evil had been punished for his deed. And now 'tis awake. Takes note of what is done, and like a prophet, looks in a glass that shows what future evils, either new or by remissness new conceived, and so in progress to be hatched and born, are now to have no successive degrees, but ere they live, to end.
Yet show some pity.
I show it most of all, but I show justice, for then I pity those I do not know. Be satisfied. Your brother dies tomorrow. Be content.
So you must be the first that gives this sentence, and he that suffers. It is excellent to have a giant's strength, but it is tyrannous to use it like a giant. Could great men thunder as Jove himself does, Jove ne'er be quiet. For every pelting petty officer would use his having for thunder, nothing but thunder. Merciful heaven, thy rather with thy sharp and sulphurous bolt splits the unwedgeable and gnarled oak than the soft myrtle. But man, proud man, dressed in a little brief authority, most ignorant of what he's most assured, his glassy essence, like an angry ape, plays such fantastic tricks upon high heaven as make the angels weep, who with our spleens would all themselves laugh mortal.
Why do you put these sayings upon me?
Because authority, though it e'er like others, hath yet a kind of medicine in itself that skins the vice o'er the top. Go to your bosom, knock there, and ask your heart what it doth know that's like my brother's offense. If it confess a natural guiltiness such as his, then let it not sound a thought upon your tongue against my brother's life.
She speaks into such sense that my sense breeds with it. I will bethink me. Come again tomorrow.
Hark, how I'll bribe you.
How? Bribe me?
Aye. With such gifts that heaven shall share with you, not with fond shackles of the test of gold or stones whose rates are either rich or poor as fancy values then, but with true prayers that shall enter in heaven and be there at sunrise, prayers from preserved souls, from fasting maids whose minds are dedicated to nothing temporal.
Well, come to me tomorrow.
At what hour tomorrow shall I attend your lordship?
At any time for noon.
Save your honor.
From thee, even from thy virtue. What's this? What's this? Is this her fault or mine? The tempter or the tempted? Who sins most? Not she, nor doth she tempt, but it is I that, lying by the violet in the sun, do as the carrion does, not as the flower, corrupt with virtuous season. Is it possible that modesty may more betray our sense than woman's lightness? Having waste ground enough, shall we desire to raise the sanctuary and pitch our evils there? Oh, fie, fie! What art thou, Angelo? Dost thou desire her foully for those things that make her good? Oh, let her brother live. Thieves for their robbery have authority when judges steal themselves. What do I love her? And I desire to hear her speak again and feast upon her eyes? What is thy dream on? Oh, cunning enemy, that to catch a saint with saints dost bait thy hook. Most dangerous that temptation that doth goad us on to sin in loving virtue. Never could the strumpet with all her double vigor, art, and nature once stir my temper, but this virtuous maid subdues me quite. Even till now, when men were fond, I smiled and wondered how.
Charity and my blessed order, I come to visit the afflicted spirits here in the prison. Do with me the common right to let me see them, to make me know the nature of their crimes that I may minister to accordingly.
I would do more than that for more needful. There's one, a gentlewoman of mine, who, falling in the flaws of her youth, have blistered her report. She's with child, and he that got it, sentenced. A young man more fit to commit another such offense than die for this.
When must he die?
So do you think tomorrow? I have provided for you. Stay a while. And you shall be conducted.
Repent, you fair one, of the sin you carry.
I do, and bear the shame most patiently.
Love you the man that wronged you?
Yes. As I love the woman that wronged him.
So then it seems your most offenseful act was mutually committed.
Mutually.
Then was your sin of heavier kind, at least?
I do confess it and repent it, Father.
Tis me so, God. But lest you do repent us that the sin hath brought you to the shame, whose sorrow is always not placed, always towards heaven, ourselves, not heaven. Show you will not spare heaven as you love it, and as you stand in fear.
I do repent me as it is an evil, and take the shame with joy.
There is. Your partner, as I hear, must die tomorrow, and I am going with instruction to him. Grace go with you. Take it easy there.
Must die tomorrow. Dearest love that respites me a life whose very comfort is still a dying horror.
When I would pray and think, I think and pray to several subjects. Heaven hath my empty words, whilst my invention, hearing not my tongue, anchors on Isabel. Heaven in my mouth, as if I did but only chew his name, and in my heart, the strong and swelling evil of my conception. Oh, place, oh, form, how often dost thou, with thy case, thy habit, wrench awe from fools, and tie the wiser souls to thy false seeming. Blood, thou art blood. Let's ride good angel on the devil's horn. 'Tis not the devil's crest. Oh, heaven, why does my blood thus muster to my heart, making both it unable for itself and dispossessing all my other parts of necessary fitness? How now? Who's there?
I've come to know your pleasure.
That you might know it would much better please me than to demand what 'tis. Your brother cannot live.
Even so, heaven keep your honor.
Yet may he live a while, and it may be as long as you or I. Yet he must die.
Under your sentence?
Yea.
When, I beseech you, that in his reprieve, longer or shorter, his soul may not sicken not.
Fie, these filthy vices. It were as good to pardon him that hath from nature stolen a man already made as to remit their saucy sweetness that do coin heaven's image in stamps that are forbid. 'Tis all as easy falsely to take away a life true made as to put metal in restrained means to make a false one.
'Tis set down so in heaven, but not on earth.
Say you so, then I shall pose you quickly. Which had you rather, that the most just law now took your brother's life, or to redeem him, give up your body to such sweet uncleanness as she that he hath stained?
Sir, believe this, I'd rather give my body than my soul.
I talk not of your soul. I'm compelled to stand more for number than for account.
How say you?
Nay, I'll not warrant that, for I can speak against the thing I say. Answer to this. I, now the voice of the recorded law, pronounce a sentence on your brother's life. Might there not be a charity in sin to save that brother's life?
Please you to do it, I'll take it as a peril to my soul. 'Tis no sin at all but charity.
Please you to do it that peril of your soul were equal poise of sin and charity.
That I do beg his life, if that be a sin, heaven let me bear it.
you, granting of my suit, if that be a sin, I'll make it my morn prayers to have it added to the faults of mine and nothing of your answer.
Nay, but hear me, your sense pursues not mine, either you are ignorant or it seems so crafted, and that's not good.
Well, let me be ignorant and in nothing good, but graciously know I am no better.
And thus wisdom wishes to appear most bright when it doth tax itself. As these black masks proclaim and shield beauty 10 times louder than beauty could display. But mark me, to be received plain, I'll speak more gross. Your brother is to die.
So.
And his life is so, as it appears, accounted to the law upon that pain.
True.
Admit no other way to save his life, as I subscribe not that, nor any other, but in the loss of question. That you, his sister, finding yourself desired of such a person whose credit with the judge or own great place could fetch your brother from the manacles of the all-building law, and that there were no earthly means to save him, but that either you must lay down the treasures of your body to this supposed, or else to let him suffer, what would you do?
As much for my poor brother as myself. That is, were I under the terms of death, the impressions of King Whips I wear as rubies, and strip myself to death as to a bed longing happened where I give my body up to shame.
Then must your brother die.
And for the cheaper way. 'Tis best that a brother die at once, and that a sister, by redeeming him, should die forever.
But were not you then as cruel as the sentence you have slandered so?
Naming and ransom and free pardon are of two houses. Lawful mercy is nothing kin to foul redemption.
You seemed of late to make the law a tyrant. And rather prove the slighting of your brother a merriment than a vice.
Pardon me, my lord. It all falls out to have what we would have. We speak not what we mean. I something do excuse the thing I hate for his advantage that I dearly love.
We are all afraid.
Else let my brother die, if not a fever, but only he, oh, and succeed thy weakness.
Nay, women are frail too.
Aye, the glass is where they view themselves, who are as easily broke as they make forms. Women, help heaven. Men their creation mar in profiting by them. Nay, call us stand time and frail, for we are as soft as our complexions, and credulous to false prints.
I think it well. And from this testimony of your own sex, I do arrest your words. Be that you are, that is, a woman, if you be more, you're none. If you be one, as you are well expressed by all external warrants, show it now, by putting on the destined livery.
I have no tongue but one, my lord. My brother did love Juliet, and you tell me he shall die for it.
He shall not, Isabel, if you give me love.
Now, I know your virtue hath a license that it, which seems a little fouler than it is, to pluck on others.
On mine honor, my words express my purpose.
Little honor to be much believed, and most pernicious purpose. I will proclaim thee, and lo, look for it. Sign me a present pardon for my brother, or with an outstretched throat I'll tell the world aloud what man thou art.
Who will believe thee, Isabel? My own soiled name? The austereness of my life? My vouch against you and my place at the stake? Will so your accusation overweigh that you shall stifle in your own report and smell of gallantry? I have begun, and now I give my sensual race the rein. Fit thy consent to my sharp appetite. Lay by all nicety and prolixious blushes that banish what they sue for. Redeem my brother by yielding up thy body to my will, or else he must not only die the death, but thy unkindness shall his death draw out to lingering sufferers. Answer me tomorrow, or by the affection that now guides me most, I'll prove a tyrant to him. As for you, say what you can. My false outweighs your true.
To whom should I complain? Did I tell this who would believe me? Oh, careless mouths that bear in them one and the self-same tongue, either condemnation or proof. Bidding the law make curtsy to their will, hooking both right and wrong to the appetite to follow as it draws. And will to my brother, hath fallen by prompture of the blood, yet happy in him such a mind of honor, that had he 20 heads to tinder down on 20 bloody blocks, he'd yield them up before his sister should her body stoop to such a poor pollution. Therefore Isabel lived chaste, and brother die. More than our brother is our chastity, I will tell him yet of Angelo's request, and fit his mind to death for his soul's rest.
Medicine, but only hope. I hope to live and am prepared to die.
Be absolute for death. Either death or life shall thereby be the sweeter. Reason thus with life. If I lose thee, I do lose a thing that none but fools would keep. Merely thou art death's fool. For him thou laborest by thy flight to shun, and yet runs toward him still. And if thou art not thyself, for thou exists on many a thousand grains that issue out of dust. Happy thou art not, for what thou hast not, still thou strives to get, and what thou hast, forgets. Thou art not thyself, for thou art not certain. For thou, complexion, shifts the strange effects after the wound. Thou rich, thou poor, but like an ass whose back with ingots bows, thou bears thy heavy riches but a journey, and death unloads thee. What's yet in this that bears the name of life? Yet in this life lie hidden 1,000 deaths. Yet death we fear, it makes these odds all even.
I humbly thank you, sir. To sue to live, I find I seek to die, and seeking death, find life. Let it come on.
But hope he's to your grace and good company.
Dear sir, ere long I'll visit you again.
Most holy sir, I thank you.
My business is a word or two with Claudio, and very welcome. Look, sir, here's your sister.
Justice, a word with you?
As many as you please.
Bring me to hear them speak, where I may be conceived.
Now, sister, what's the comfort?
Why, as all comforts are, most good indeed. Lord Angelo, having affairs to heaven, intends you for his swift ambassador, where you shall be an everlasting leisure. Therefore, your best appointment make with speed. Tomorrow you set on.
But is there no remedy?
None. But such a remedy as to save a head, to cleave a heart in twain.
But is there any?
Yes, brother, you may live. There is a devilish mercy in the judge, if you implore it, that will free your life, but fetter you till death.
Perpetual durance?
Aye, just. Perpetual durance. A restraint. Though all the world's vicinity, you had to a determined scope.
But in what nature?
In such a one as you consenting to it would bark that honor from the trunk you bear and leave you naked.
Get me to the point.
Darest thou die? The sense of death is most in apprehension. And that poor beetle that we tread upon in corporal sufferance finds a pain as great as when a giant dies.
Why give you me this shame? Think you I can resolution fetch from flowery tenderness? If I must die, I will encounter darkness as a bride and hug it in mine arms.
There spake my mother. There my father's grave did utter forth a voice. Yes, thou must die. Thou art too noble to conserve a life in base appliances. This outward sainted deputy whose settled visage and determined word nips youth in the head and follies doth anew as falcon doth the fowl, is yet a devil. His filth within being cast, he would appear upon as deep as hell.
Justice Angelo.
Oh, 'tis a cunning livery of hell, the damnedest body to invest and cover in frenzy guards. Dost thou think, Claudio, that if I would yield to him my virginity, thou mightst be free?
Cannot be.
expect so to offend him still? This night's the time that I should do what I abhor to name, or else thou diest tomorrow.
Thou shalt not do it.
Oh, were it but my life, I'd throw it down for your deliverance as frankly as a pin.
Thanks, dear Isabel.
Be ready, Claudio, for your death tomorrow.
Yes. Has he affections in him that would make him bite the law by the nose when he would force it? I mean, surely it is no sin, nor of the deadly seven it is the least.
Which is the least?
If it were so damnable, and he being so wise, why would he for a momentary trick be perdurably fined? Oh, Isabel.
What says my mother?
Death is a fearful thing.
A shaped life, a hateful.
Aye, but to die and go we know not where, to lie in cold obstruction and to rot, this the sensible warm motion to become a kneaded clod, and the delighted spirit to bathe in fiery floods, or reside in thrilling region of thick ribbed ice, or to be imprisoned in the viewless winds and blown about the repentant world. The weariest and most loathsome life that age, ache, penury, and imprisonment can lay on nature is a paradise to what we fear of death.
Alas,
sweet sister, let me live. The sin you do to save a brother's life, nature dispenses with the deed so far that it becomes a virtue.
Oh, you beast! Faithless coward! Wilt thou be made a man out of my vice? It's not a kind of incest to take thy life from mine own sister's shame. Take my defiance. Die. Perish. Might but my bending down reprieve thee from thy fate. It should proceed. I'll pray a thousand prayers for thy death. No words to save thee.
Then hear me, Isabel.
Fie, thy sin's not accidental, but a trade. Mercy given to thee would prove itself a bond. 'Tis best thou diest quickly.
Hear me, Isabella!
Vouchsafe a word, young sister. But one word.
What is your will?
Might you dispense with your leisure, I would by and by have some speech with you. The satisfaction I would require is likewise your own benefit.
I have no leisure. My stay must be stolen out of other affairs, but I will attend you a while.
Son. I have overheard what has passed between you and your sister. Angelo had never the purpose to corrupt her, only he hath made an essay of a virtue to practice his judgment with the disposition of natures. She, having the truth of honor in her, hath made him that gracious denial which he is most glad to receive. I am confessor to Angelo, and I know this to be true. Therefore, prepare yourself to death. Do not satisfy your resolution with hopes that are fallible. Tomorrow you must die. Go to your knees and make ready.
Let me ask my sister pardon. I'm so out of love with life, I will sue to be rid of it.
Hold you there. Farewell. The hand that has made you fair has made you good. The goodness that is cheap in beauty makes beauty brief in goodness. But grace, being the soul of your complexion, shall keep the body of it ever fair. The assault that Angelo hath made to you, fortune hath conveyed to my understanding, and but that frailty hath examples for his falling, I should wonder at Angelo. How will you do to pretend to substitute and to save your brother?
I'm no going now to resolve him. I'd rather my brother die by the law than my son should be unlawfully born. But oh, how much the good Duke is deceived in Angelo. If ever he return and I can speak to him, I will discover his government.
That shall not be much amiss. Yet as the matter now stands, he will avoid your accusation. He made trial of you only. Therefore, fasten your ear on my advices. To the love I have in doing good, a remedy presents itself. I do make myself believe that you may most uprighteously do a poor wrong lady a merited benefit. Redeem your brother from the angry law, do no stain to your own gracious person, and much please the absent Duke, if peradventure he shall ever return to have hearing of his business. Have you
you not heard speak of Mariana, the sister of Frederick, the brave soldier who miscarried at sea? Oh, she should this Angelo have married, and the nuptial appointed, between which time of the contract and limit of the solemnity, her brother Frederick was wrecked at sea, having in that perished vessel the dowry of his sister. But mark how heavily this befell to the poor general. There she lost a noble and renowned brother in his love toward her, ever most kind and natural. With him, the portion and sinew of her fortune, her marriage dowry. With both her competent husband, this well-seeming Angelo.
Can this be so? Did Angelo so leave her?
He left her in her tears, and dried not one of them with his comfort. Swallowed his vows whole, pretending in her discoveries of dishonor. In few, bestowed her on her own lamentation, which she yet wears for his sake.
What corruption is in this life that it should let this man live? But how out of this can she avail?
Why, it is a rupture that you may easily heal. And the cure of it not only saves your brother, but keeps you from dishonor in doing it.
Show me how, good father.
Go to you with Angelo. Answer his requiring with a plausible obedience. Agree with his demands to the point. Only refer yourself to this advantage. First, that your stay with him may not be long, that the time may have all shadow and silence in it. And now follows all. We shall advise this wronged maid to stead up your appointment. Go in your place. If the encounter acknowledge itself hereafter, it may compel him to a repentance. And here, by this, is your brother saved, your honor untainted, the poor Mariana advantaged, and the corrupt deputy scaled. The doubleness of the benefit defends the deceit from reproof. What think you of it?
The image of it gives me content already, and I trust it will grow to a most prosperous perfection.
It lies much in your holding up. Haste you speedily to Angelo. I will presently to this dejected Mariana. At that place, call upon me, and dispatch with Angelo, that it may be quickly.
Thank you for this comfort. Fare you well, good father.
Nay, if there be no remedy for it, but you'll need five thou men and women like beasts. We shall all the world reach round my bastard.
Oh, heavens, what stuff is here?
Since ever married world sense of two usuries, the merriest was put down, and the worser allowed, by order of law, a furred gown to keep him warm.
Cutter, sir.
What offense hath this man made, sir?
Marry, sir, he hath offended the law. And, sir, we think him to be a thief, too, sir. For we have found upon him a strange picklock, which we have sent to the deputy.
Fie, sirrah. A bond. A wicked bond. The evil that thou causest to be done, that is thy means to live. Canst thou believe thy living is a life so stinkingly depending? Go, men. Go, men. Take him to prison, officer. Correction and destruction must both work, and this rude beast will profit.
We must to the deputy, sir. She has given him warning. And his neck will come to your waist accord, sir.
I spy comfort, I cry bail. Here's a gentleman and a friend of mine.
How now, noble Pompey? What, at the wheels of Caesar? Art thou glad in triumph? What sayest thou to this matter, method, and tune? Art going to prison, Pompey?
Yes, faith, sir!
Well, 'tis not amiss. Farewell, Pompey. Say I sent thee thither.
For debt, Pompey?
For being a bond. For being a bond.
Well then, imprison him if imprisonment be the due of a bond. Why, 'tis his right. Bond is he doubtless, and of antiquity too, bond born. Farewell, Pompey. Go, commend me to the prison, Pompey. You will turn good husband now, Pompey. You will keep the house.
I hope, sir, your good worship would be my bail.
No, indeed. Will I not, Pompey? It is not the wear. I will pray, Pompey, to increase your bondage. If you take it not patiently, why, your mettle is the more. Adieu, Pompey. Bless you, father.
You will not bail me then, sir?
Then, Pompey, nor now.
Come your way, sir.
Go to jail, Pompey! Go! What news, father, of the Duke?
I know none. Can you tell me of any?
Some say he is with the Emperor of Russia. Others some, he is in Rome. Where is he, think you?
I know not where, but wheresoever I wish him well.
It was a mad, fantastical trick of him to steal from the state and usurp the beggary he was never born to. Where is he, think you?
I know not where.
You know, that Lord Angelo, he does duke it out well in his presence. He puts transgression to it.
He does well in it.
A little lenity and lechery could do no harm in him. Something too crabbed that way, Father.
It is too general a vice, and severity must cure it.
Yes, but it is impossible to extirp it quite, Father, till eating and drinking be put down. They say this Angelo was not made of man and woman by this downright way of creation. Is it true, think you?
How should he be made, then?
Some report that a sea maid spawned him. Some he was begot between two stockfishes. But it is certain, when he makes water, his urine is congealed ice. That I know to be true.
You are pleasant, sir, and speak the peace.
What a ruthless thing is this in him for the rebellion of a codpiece to take away the life of a man. Would the duke that is absent have done this? He had some feeling of the sport. He knew the service, and that instructed him to mercy.
I never heard the absent duke much detected for women. He was not inclined that way.
Oh, sir, you are deceived.
It is not possible.
Who? Not the duke? The duke had crotchets in him. He would be drunk, too, but that let me inform you.
You're doing wrong, sure.
Sir, I was an inward of his. A shy fellow was the duke, but I believe I know the cause of his withdrawing.
What, I prithee, might be the cause?
No, pardon. 'Tis a secret must be locked within the teeth and lips. But this I can let you understand. The greater file of the subject held the duke to be wise.
Wise? Why, no question but he was.
A very superficial, ignorant, unweighing fellow.
Either this is the envy in you, folly, or mistaking. The very stream of his life and the business he has held must, upon a warranted need, give him a better proclamation. Therefore, you speak unskillfully. Or if your knowledge be more, it is much darker than your malice.
Come, sir. I know what I know.
I can hardly believe that, since you know not what you speak. But if ever the duke return, as our prayers are you made, let me desire you to make your answer before him. If it be honest you have spoke, you have courage to maintain it. I am bound to call upon you, and I pray you. Your name?
Sir, my name is Lucio, well known to the duke.
He shall know you better, sir, if I am needed to report you.
I feared you not.
Oh, you hope the duke will return no more. Or you imagine me too unhurtful and opposite.
I'll be hanged first. Thou art deceived in me, Father. But no more of this. Can you tell if Claudio die tomorrow or no?
Why should he die, sir?
Why? For filling a bottle with a tundish. I wish the duke we spoke of would return again. The ungenitured agent will unpeople the province with continency. The duke yet would have dark deeds darkly answered. He would never bring them to light when he were returned. He would mouth with a beggar, though she smelt brown bread and garlic. Say that I said so. Farewell.
No might nor greatness in mortality can censure-scape. What king so strong can tie the gall up in the slanderous tongue? But who comes here?
Go, not the first.
Good, my lord, be good to me. Your honor is a kind of merciful woman. Good, my lord.
I bought 11 years continuance, but please, your honor.
My lord, this is one Lucio's information against me. Mistress Kate Keepdown was with child by him in the Duke's time. He promised her marriage. His child is a year and a quarter old. I have kept him myself, and see how he goes about to abuse me? Go to. No more words.
Angelo will not be altered. Claudio must die tomorrow. Let him be furnished with divines and have all charitable preparations, so please you. And advise him for the entertainment of death.
Bliss and goodness on you.
Of whence are you?
Not of this country, though my choice is now to use it for my time. I am a brother of gracious order, late come from the sea, in special business from his holiness.
Oh, what news abroad in the world?
None, but that there is so great a fever on goodness that the dissolution of it must cure it. There is scarce truth enough alive to make society secure, yet security enough to make fellowships accursed. Much upon this riddle runs the wisdom of the world. This news is old enough, yet it is every day's news. I pray you, madam, of what disposition was the duke?
One that above all other strifes contended especially to know himself.
What pleasure was he given to?
Rather rejoicing to see another marry than marry at anything professed to make him rejoice. A gentleman of all temperance, but leave we him to his events with a prayer that they prove prosperous, And let me desire to know how you find Claudio prepared.
He professes to have received no sinister measure from his judge, but most willingly humbles himself to the determination of justice.
Mm. Pay the heavens your function and the prisoner the very debt of your calling. I have labored for the poor gentleman to the extremest shores of my modesty, but my brother Justice, have I found him so severe that he hath forced me to tell him that he is indeed Justice?
If his own life answer the straightness of his requiring, it shall be coming well. Wherein, if he chance to fail, he is sentenced himself.
I'm going to visit the prisoner. Fare you well.
Peace be with you. He who the sword of heaven will bear should be as holy as severe, patterning himself to know grace to stand and virtue go, more nor less to others paying than by self-offenses weighing. Shame to him whose cruel striking kills for faults of his own liking, twice treble shame on Angelo. To weed my vice and let his grow, what may man within him hide, though angel on the outward side. From this good deputy.
He hath a garden, circumvented with brick, whose western side is to a vineyard backed. And to that vineyard there's a planted gate that makes his opening with this figure key. This other doth command the little door, which from the vineyard to his garden leads. And there have I made my promise upon the heavy middle of the night to call upon him. He did show me the way twice over.
Are there no other tokens between you agreed concerning her observance?
No, none but a repair in the dark. And that I possess to my most stay can be but brief. For I have told him that a servant comes with me along and waits upon me, whose possession is I come about my brother.
'Tis well borne up. What is the news from this good deputy? Much upon this time have I promised here to be.
You have not been inquired after. I have been here all day. I come to desire you to do the like.
Yes. Do you persuade yourself that I respect you?
Good father, I know it and have found it.
Take then this your companion by the hand, who has a story ready for your ear. I shall attend your leisure, but make haste. The vapor's night approaches.
Please walk aside.
Oh, place and greatness. Millions of false eyes are stuck upon thee. Volumes of report run with these false and most contrarious quests upon thy doings. Thousand escapes of wit make thee the father of their idle dreams and wreck thee in their fancies. Welcome. Albert.
She will take the enterprise upon her, if you advise it.
It is not my consent, but my entreaty too.
Little have you to say when you depart from him, but soft and low, remember now, my brother. Fear me not.
Nor, gentle daughter, fear you not at all. He is your husband on a pre-contract. To bring you thus together, 'tis no sin, if that the justice of your title to him doth flourish the deceit. Come, let us go. Our corns to reap, for yet our tithes to sow.
Look, here's the warrant for Claudio. 'Tis now dead midnight, and by 8 tomorrow thou must be made immortal. Who can do good on him by and by. I hope there be some pardon or reprieve for the most gentle Claudio.
The best and wholesomest spirits of the night envelop you, good justice. Who called here late?
None since the curfew rung.
Not Isabel?
No.
They will in every long.
What comfort is for Claudio?
There's some in hope.
It is a bitter deputy.
Not so, not so. His life is paralleled even with the stroke and line of his great justice. He does with holy abstinence subdue that in himself which he spurs on his power to qualify in others. Were he mild with that which he corrects, then were he tyrannous. But this being so, he's just. Is near the dawning justice as it is. You shall hear more ere morning.
Happily. You something know. Yet I believe there comes no countermand. No example have we besides, upon the very seat of justice, Lord Angelo hath to the public ear professed the contrary.
This is his pardon, purchased by such sin for which the pardoner himself is in. Hence hath offense his quick celerity when it is born in high authority. When vice makes mercy, mercy's so extended that for the false love is the offender friended. Now, madam, what news?
Whatsoever you may hear to the contrary, let Claudio be executed by 4 o'clock and Barnadine in the afternoon. For my better satisfaction, let me have Claudio's head sent me by 5. Thus, let this be duly performed with a thought that more depends on it than we must yet deliver. Fail not to do your office or answer it at your peril. What say you to this, sir?
What is that Barnaby who is to be executed in the afternoon?
His friends still wrought reprieves for him, and indeed his fact until now in Lord Angelo's government came not to an undoubtful proof.
It's more of him and I. There is written in your brow, justice, honesty and constancy. I will lay myself in hazard. Claudio, whom here you have warned to execute, is no greater forfeit to the law than Angelo who has sentenced him. To make you understand this in a manifest effect, I crave with 4 days' respite, for the which you are to do me both a present and a dangerous courtesy.
Pray, sir, in what?
In the delaying death.
Alack, how may I do it? Having the hour limited and an express command upon penalty to deliver his head in the view of Angelo, I may make my case as to Claudio's to cross this in the slightest.
By the vow of mine order, I warrant you, if my instructions may be your guide, that this Barnardine be this morning executed, and his head borne to Angelo.
Angelo hath seen them both, and will discover the favor.
Death's a great disguiser, and you may add to it. Shave the head, and tie the beard, and say it was the desire of the penitent to be so bared before his death. You know the course is common.
Pardon me, good father, that is against my oath.
Were you sworn to the Duke, or to the deputy?
To him, and to his substitutes.
You shall think you have made no offense. Is the Duke avouched the justice of your dealing?
Oh, but what likelihood is in that?
Not a resemblance, but a certainty. Yet since I see you fearful that neither my coat, integrity, nor persuasion can with ease tempt you, I will go further than I meant, to pluck all fears out of you. Look you, madam. Here is the hand and seal of the Duke. You shall in honor read it at your pleasure, where you shall find within these 2 days he will be here. This is a thing that Angelo knows not. Look, the unfolding star calls up the shepherd. Put not yourself into amazement how these things should be. All difficulties are but easy when they are known. Call your executioner and off with Barnardine's head. I will give him a present shrift and advise him for a better place. Yet you are amazed, but this shall absolutely resolve you. Come away. It is almost weird on.
I am as well acquainted here as I was in our house of profession. One would think it is Mistress Overdone's own house, for here be many of her old customers. First, here's young Master Rash, in for a in for a commodity of brown paper and old ginger, 97 pounds, of which he made 5 marks, ready money. Mary, ginger wasn't much in request, for the old women were all dead. Then is there Master Caper, at the suit of Master Three Pile the Mercer, in for some 4 suits of peach-colored satin, which now peaches him a beggar. Then we have young Dizzy, and Master Deepfow, and Master Copperspur, and Master Starblackie the Rapier and Daggerman, and the wild half-can that killed Lusty Pudding, and Master Forthlight the Tilter, and Brave Master Shooty the Great Traveler, and the Drop Air, and I think 40 more. All great doers in our trade, and are now for the Lord's sake.
Here in the prison, Father, there died this morning a cruel fever, one Ragazine, a most notorious pirate, a man of Claudio's years, his head and beard just of his color. What if we do omit this reprobate till he were well inclined, and satisfy the deputy with the visage of Ragazine more like to Claudio's?
Oh, 'tis an accident that heaven provides. Dispatch it presently. The hour draws on, prefixed by Angelo. See this be done and sent according to command. Quick, dispatch, and send the head to Angelo. Now will I write letters to Angelo, the provost he shall bear them, whose contents shall witness to him I am near at home, and that by great injunctions I am bound to enter publicly. Him I'll desire to meet me at the consecrated fount, the league below the city, and from thence, by cold gradation and well-balanced form, we shall proceed with Angelo.
He's called me here.
The tongue of Isabel. She's come to know if younger brother's pardon be come hither. But I will keep her ignorant of her good to make her heavenly comforts of despair when it is least expected.
By your leave, hath yet the deputy sent my brother's pardon?
He hath released him, Isabel, from the world. His head is off and sent to Angelo.
Nay, but it is not so.
It is no other. Show your wisdom, daughter, in your close patience.
I will to him and pluck out his eyes.
He shall not be admitted to his sight.
Unhappy Claudio. Wretched Isabel. Injurious world and most damned Angelo.
This nor hurts him, nor profits him a jot. Forbear it, therefore. Give your cause to heaven. Mark what I say, that you shall find by every syllable a faithful verity. The Duke comes home tomorrow. Nay, dry your eyes. One of our convent and his confessor gives me this instance. Already he has carried notice to Aeschylus and Angelus, who do prepare to meet him at the gates. They had to give up their power. If you can, pace your wisdom in that good path that I would wish it go, and you shall have your bosom on this wretch. Grace of the Duke. Revenge is to your heart and general honor.
And directed by you.
This letter, then, to Friar Peter, 'tis that he sent me of the Duke's return. Say by this token, I desire his company at Mariana's house tonight. Her cause and yours, I'll perfect him withal, and he shall bring you before the Duke and to the head of Angelo, accusing home and all. For my poor self, I am confined by a sacred vow and shall be absent. When you with this letter, command these spreading waters from your eyes with a light heart. 'Twas not my holy order if I revert your course. Who's here?
Good evening, Father. Where's the justice?
Not within, sir.
Oh, pretty Isabella, I am pale at mine heart to see thine eyes so red. Thou must be patient. The Duke will be here tomorrow. By my troth, Isabel, I love your brother. If the old fantastical Duke of Dark Waters had been at home, he had lived.
Sir, the Duke is marvelous a little beholding to your reports. But the best is, he lives not even.
Father, thou knowest not the Duke so well as I do. He's a better woodman than thou takest him for.
Well, you'll answer this one day. Very well.
Hey, Terry, I'll go along with thee. I can tell thee pretty tales of the Duke.
You have told me too many of him already, sir, if they be true. If not true, none were enough.
I was once before him for getting a Winchester child.
Did you such a thing?
Yes, Mary, did I, but I was fain to forswear it. They else would have married me to the rotten meddler.
Sir, your company is fairer than honest. Rest you well.
By my troth, I'll go with thee to the lane's inn. If body talk offend you, we'll have none of it. Nay, Father, I will burr, I will stick.
deed unshapes me quite, makes me unpregnant and dull to all proceedings. I deflowered maid, and by an eminent body that enforced the law against it. But that her tender shame will not proclaim against her maiden loss how much she tongued me. Yet reason dares her know, for my authority bears of a Cretan bolt that no particular scandal once can touch, but it confounds the breather. You should have lived, save that riotous youth might in the times to come have taken ransom of such shame. But yet he had lived. Alack, when once our grace we have forgot, nothing goes right. We would, and we would not.
Every letter he hath writ hath been about another.
Most uneven and distracted manner. His actions show much like to madness. Pray heaven his wisdom be not tainted. And why should we meet him at the gates and re-deliver our authorities there?
Oh, I guess not.
And why proclaim it in an hour before his entering that if any crave redress of injustice, they should exhibit their petitions in the street?
Well, he shows his reason for that, to have dispatch of complaints and to deliver us from any devices henceforth which shall then have no power to stand against us.
Well, I beseech you, let it be proclaimed.
My very worthy cousin, fairly met. Our old and faithful friend, we are glad to see you.
A happy return be to your royal grace.
Many and hearty thankings to you both. We have made inquiry, and we hear such goodness of your justice that our soul cannot but yield you forth to public thanks.
You make my bond still greater.
Oh, your desert speaks loud. And I should wrong it to lock it in the wards of covert bosom, when it deserves, with characters of brass, a forted residence against the tooth of time and razor of oblivion. Give me your hand. And let the subject see. To make them know that outward courtesies would fain proclaim favors that keep within.
Justice, O royal duke, vain in regard upon a wrong that I would fain have said, a maid. Royal prince, dishonor not your eye on any other object before you have heard me in my true complaint and given me justice, 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 justice.
Relate your wrongs. In what? By whom? Be brief. Here is Lord Angelo shall give you justice. Reveal yourself to him.
Hear me yourself, O worthy duke, for you bid me seek redemption of the devil. For that which I must speak must either punish me not being believed or wring redress from you. Hear me, or hear me here.
My lord, her wits, I fear me, are not firm. She hath been a suitor to me for her brother, cut off by course of justice.
By course of justice.
And she will speak most bitterly and strange.
Most strange, but yet most truly will I speak. That Angelo is forsworn, is it not strange? That Angelo is a murderer, is it not strange? That Angelo is an adulterous thief, a hypocrite, a virgin violator, is it not strange and strange?
Nay, it is 10 times strange.
It is not more true that he is Angelo than this is all. True as it is strange. Nay, 10 times truer, for truth is truth to the end of reckoning. 'Tis not impossible that one, the wickedest caitiff on the ground, may seem as shy, as grave, as just, as absolute as Angelo. Even so may Angelo and all his characters, titles, forms, dressings, be an arch villain. Royal prince, believe it. Pity less, he is nothing, but he's more had I more name for badness.
By my honesty, if she be mad, as I believe no other, her madness hath the oddest frame of sense, such a dependency of thing on thing as e'er I heard in madness.
Worthy duke, harp not on that, nor do not banish reason for inequality, but let your reason serve to make the truth appear where it seems hid, and hide the false seems true.
Many that are not mad have sure more lack of reason. What would you say?
I am a sister of one Claudio, condemned upon the act of fornication, to lose his head, condemned by Angelo. I, in the probation of a sisterhood, was sit for by my brother, one Lucio, as then the messenger.
That's I, and like your grace, I came to her from Claudio, and desire her try her gracious fortune with Lord Angelo for her poor brother's pardon.
That's he, indeed.
You were not bid to speak.
No, my good lord, nor wish to hold my peace.
I wish you now, then. Pray you take note of it. And when you have a business for yourself, pray heaven you then be perfect.
I warrant your honor.
The warrant's for yourself. Take heed to it.
This gentleman did somewhat tell of my tale.
Right!
You may be right, but you are in the wrong to speak before your time. Proceed.
In brief, to set the needless process by, how I persuaded, how I prayed and kneeled, how he repelled me, and how I replied to this was of much length. The vile conclusion I now began with grief and shame to utter. He would not, but by gift of my chaste body to his concupiscible, intemperate lust, release my brother. And after much debatement, my sisterly remorse confutes my honor, and I did yield to him. But the next morn betimes, his purpose so fitting, he sends a warrant for my poor brother's head.
This is most likely.
Though it were as like as it is true.
Ay, heaven fond wretch, thou knowest not what thou speakst, or else thou art suborned against his honor in hateful practice. First, his integrity stands without blemish. Next, it imports no reason that with such vehemency he should pursue faults proper to himself. If he had so offended, he would have weighed thy brother by himself, and not have cut him off. Someone has set you on. Confess the truth, and say by whose advice thou camest here to complain.
It is this all. And gracious ministers above, keep me in patience, and with ripened time, unfold the evil which is here wrapped up in countenance. Heaven shield your grace from woe, as I this wrong hence unbelieved go.
I know you'd fain be gone. This needs must be a practice. Who knew of your intent in coming hither?
One that I would were here, Father Lodovic.
Who knows that, Lodovic?
My lord, I know him. And this meddling priest, I do not like the man. For certain things, had he been lay, my lord, that he had said in your absence, I had swinged him soundly.
Words against me. This is a good priest, belike. And to set on this wretched woman here against our substitute, let this priest be found.
But yesterday night, my lord, I saw her and the priest in the prison. A saucy fellow, a very scurvy priest.
You do not smile at this, Lord Andrew. Oh, heaven, the vanity of wretched fools. Give us a seat. Come, cousin Angelo. In this I'll be impartial. Be you judge of your own cause. Is this the witness? First let her show her face, and after speak.
Pardon, my lord, I will not show my face until my husband bid me.
What, are you married?
No, my lord.
Are you a maid?
No, my lord.
A widow, then?
Neither, my lord.
Why, you know nothing, then. Neither maid, widow, nor wife.
My lord, I do confess that I never was married, and I confess besides that I am no maid. I have known my husband, yet my husband knows not that ever he knew me.
He was drunk then, my lord, it could be no better.
For the benefit of silence, would thou wert so too.
Well, my lord.
This is no witness for Lord Angelo.
My lord, now I come to it. She that accuses him of fornication in self-same manner doth accuse my husband, and charges him, my lord, with such a time when I'll depose I had him in mine arms with all the effect of love.
Charges she more than me?
Not that I know.
No? You say your husband?
Why, just, my lord. And that is Angelo, who thinks that he never knew my body, but knows he thinks that he knows Isabel's.
This is a strange abuse. Let's see thy face.
My husband bids me. Now I will unmask. This is that face, thou cruel Angelo, which once thou swore was worth the looking on. This is the hand which, with a vowed contract, was fast be locked in thine. This is the body that took away the match from Isabel, and did supply thee in thy garden house in her imagined person.
Know you this woman?
My lord, I must confess I know this woman. And 5 years since, there was some speech of marriage betwixt myself and her, which was broke off, partly for that her promised proportions came short of composition, but in chief for that her reputation was disvalued in levity, since which time of 5 years I never spake with her, saw her, nor heard from her, upon my faith and honor.
Noble prince, as there comes light from heaven and words from breath, as there is sense in truth and truth in virtue, I am affianced this man's wife as strongly as words can make up vows. And my good lord, but Tuesday night last gone in his guardian house, he knew me as a wife.
My patience here is touched. Now, good my lord, give me the scope of justice. I do perceive these poor informal women are no more but instruments of some more mightier member that sets them on. Let me have way, my lord, to find this practice out.
Ah, with my heart, and punish them to your height of pleasure. You, Lady Escalus, sit with my cousin, lend in your kind pains to find out this abuse, whence tis derived. This priest indeed has set the women on to this abuse. Let him be sent for. And you, my noble and well-warranted cousin, whom it concerns to hear this matter forth, do with your injuries as seems you best in any chastisement. I for a while will leave you, but stir not you till you have well determined upon these slanders.
My lord, we'll do it thoroughly. Signor Lucio, did not you say you knew this priest to be a dishonest person?
Honest and nothing but in his clothes, and one who hath spoke most villainous speeches of the Duke.
We'll entreat you to abide here and enforce them against him. We shall find this priest a notable fellow.
As any in the city, on my word.
Isabel, I would speak with you. Come on, mistress, here's this gentlewoman who denies all that you say.
Madame, here's that rascal I spoke of.
In good time, speak not into him until we call you. Come, sir. Did you set these women upon to slander Lord Angelo?
Tis false. Where is the Duke? Tis he should hear you speak.
Oh, the Duke is in us, and we will hear you speak. Look, you speak justly.
Boldly, at least. But, poor souls, come you to seek the lamb here of the fox? Good night to your redress. Is the Duke gone? Then is your cause gone, too. The Duke's unjust thus to retort your manifest appeal and put your trial in the villain's mouth which here you come to accuse. The Duke dare no more stretch this finger of mine than he dare rack his own. His subject am I not, nor here provincial. My business in this state made me a looker-on here in the city, where I have seen corruption boil and bubble till it all run the stew.
What can you vouch against him, Signor Lucio? Is this not the person you spoke of?
Tis me, madame. Come hither. Do you know me?
I remember you, sir, by the sound of your voice. I met you at the prison in the absence of the Duke.
Oh, did you so? And do you remember what you said of the Duke?
Most notably, sir.
And was the Duke a fleshmonger, a fool, and a coward, as you then reported him to be?
You must, sir, change persons with me ere you make that my report. You indeed spoke so of it, and much more. Much worse.
Oh, thou damnable fellow, did not I pluck thee by the nose for thy hateful speeches?
I protest I love the Duke as I love myself.
Hark, how the villain would close now after his treasonable abuses. Come, sir, show your knave's visage with a pox to you.
Thou art the first knave that e'er mazed a duke. Sneak not away, sir, for the priest and you must have a word anon.
This may prove worse than hanging.
Sir, by your leave, as thou for word or wit or impudence that yet can do thee office, if thou hast, rely upon it till my tale be heard, and hold no longer out.
Oh, my dread lord, should be guiltier than my guiltiness to think I can be undiscernible when I perceive your grace like power divine and looked upon my passes. Then, good prince, no longer session hold upon my shame, but let my trial be mine own confession. Immediate sentence then and sequent death is all the grace I beg.
Come hither, Marianne. Say, wast thou e'er contracted to this woman?
I was, my lord.
Go. Take her hence and marry her instantly. Do you the office, justice.
My lord, I am more amazed at his dishonor than at the strangeness of it.
Come hither, Isabel. Your priest is now your prince. As I was then, not changing heart with habit, I am still attorney at your service. Your brother's death, I know, sits at your heart, and you may marvel why I obscured myself in laboring to save his life, and would not rather make rash remonstrance of my hidden power than let him so be lost. Oh, most kind me, it was the swift celerity of his death, which I did think with slower foot came on, that brained my purpose. But peace be with you. That life is better life than past fearing death, than that which lives to fear. Make it your comfort. So happy is your brother.
I do, my lord.
For this new married man approaching here, whose salt imagination yet hath wronged your well-defended honor, you must pardon for Marianna's sake. But as he adjudged your brother, being criminal in double violation of sacred chastity and of promise breach, thereon depending for your brother's life, The very mercy of the law cries out, most audible, even from his proper tongue, an Angelo for Claudio, death for death. Haste still pays haste, and leisure answers leisure. Like doth quit like, and measure still for measure. Then, Angelo, thy fault thus manifested, which though thou wouldst deny, denies thee banished. We do condemn thee to the very block where Claudio stooped to death, and with like haste, away with him.
Oh, my most gracious lord, I hope you will not mock me with a husband.
It is your husband mocked you with a husband. Consenting to the safeguard of your honor, I thought your marriage fit, else imputation, for that he knew you, might reproach your life and choke your good to come. For his possessions, although by confiscation they are ours, we do instate and widow you withal, to buy you a better husband.
Dear lord, I crave no other nor no better man.
Never crave him, we are definitive.
Isabel, take my part. Lend me your gaze, and for all my life to come, I'll lend you all my life to do you service.
Against all sense, you do importune her. Should she kneel down in mercy of this act, her brother's ghost his haven bed would break, and take her hence in horror.
Isabel, speak, Isabel. Do yet but kneel by me. Hold up your hand, say nothing. I'll speak all. They say best men are molded out of faults, and for the most become much more the better for being a little bad. So may my husband. Not let me
he dies for Claudio's death.
Most bounteous sir. Look upon this man condemned as if my brother lived, and let him not die. For my brother had but justice in that he did the thing for which he died. For Angelo, his act not o'ertake his bad intent, and must be buried as an intent that perished by the way. Thoughts are no subjects, intents, but merely thoughts.
Your suit's unprofitable. Stand up, I say. I have bethought me of another fault. Aeschylus, how came it Claudio was beheaded at an unusual hour?
It was commanded, sir.
Had you a special warrant for the deed?
No, my good lord, it was my private message.
For which I do discharge you of your office. Give up your keys.
Pardon me, noble lord. By testimony whereof, in the prison, one who should have by private order have died, I have reserved alive.
I am sorry that such sorrow I procure, and so deep sticks it in my penitent heart that I crave death more willingly than mercy. It is my deserving, and I do entreat it.
This is another prisoner I have saved, who should have died when Claudio lost his head, almost like Claudio as himself.
If he be like your brother, for his sake is he pardoned. And for your lovely sake, give me your hand and say you will be mine. He is my brother too. Fitter time for that. By this, Lord Angelo perceives he's safe. Methinks I see a quickening in his eye. Well, Angelo, your evil quits you well. Look that you love your wife, her worth yours. I find an apt remission in myself. And yet here's one in place I cannot pardon. You, Sirrah, that knew me for a fool, a coward, one all of luxury, an ass, a madman. Wherein have I so deserved of you that you extol me thus? Proclaim it, round about the city. Is any woman wronged by this lewd fellow, as I have heard him swear himself there's one whom he begot with child? Let her appear.
Faith, my lord, I spoke it, but according to the trick. If you'll hang me for it, you may, but I had rather it would please you I might be whipped.
Whipped first, sir, and hanged after. Genie Claudio, if you wrong, will be restored. Joy to you, Mariana. Love her, Angelo. I have confessed her, and I know her virtue. Thanks, good friend Aeschylus, for thy much goodness. For that care and secrecy, we shall employ thee in a worthier place. Dear Isabel, I have a motion much imports your good. Whereto, if you'll a willing ear incline, what's mine is yours, and what is yours is mine. So, bring us to our palace, where we'll show what's yet behind that's meat you all should know.
Maybe this schism is just a symptom of late capitalism.